to me, the reason why you have a vision is to inspire and attract, and, you know, not just clients, but it's actually attracting and inspiring team and also partners. And you think about your business, those, if you can really inspire and attract the like-minded people, then that's a great starting point.
Some of you already know Andrew Marmont, who's been a client of ours for a long time. He does a lot of work with our clients in terms of helping them do copywriting. And he's a great writer. And more recently, he's jumped on the bandwagon with Vivid Vision and helping people understand and clarify and get in writing what they do with their vision. So I asked him to just do a short segment for us today, just to explain the process and the power, just from his experience, because he's now worked with a number of clients with this Vivid Vision idea and helping them extract their insights. So Andrew, welcome to the stage.
Thank you, David. Thank you, everyone.
So we're going to do this as a little bit of a dialogue, and I'm going to attempt to take some notes as Andrew speaks, because he's got a lot of wise words on this topic. So I'm going to hand the keys over to you, Andrew, and let you drive the conversation, and let's see what we can come up with.
Sure. Thanks, David. I think the first thing with vision, you know, we're talking about with some people before. To me, the reason why you have a vision is to inspire and attract, and, you know, not just clients, but it's actually attracting and inspiring team and also partners. And you think about your business, those, if you can really inspire and attract the like-minded people, then that's a great starting point. So, or just a way to think about what a vision is.
Yes. So it's a funny thing. You mentioned this whole idea of attraction, and this used to bug me when I started my business because of that statement I made before. You know, you get the people in business you deserve. It's the same with clients, by the way. You get the clients in business you deserve. So if your clients are running you in circles and you're frustrating you, stop complaining and stop looking at them and start looking in the mirror. And this is where the Vivid Vision forces people, I suppose, to actually say, what do you want? What do you stand for? And let's articulate this in a document. So can you run through a bit of the process and the experience?
Yeah, I think the first one is a great way to do it is actually get outside your normal area. So maybe go to a park. That really worked for me. And actually being in nature, and actually it gives you a chance to really think beyond the normal confines and expand your thinking. And there's a process that they say to go through, but essentially, you know, you want to, I think the first thing to think about is actually, you know, thinking big, then almost like times it by 10, you know, because the idea of this vision is to actually, it's not going to be for everyone. It actually, if you can think as big as possible, then it actually is going to disengage people, which is a good thing because they're not going to be on board with your mission. Like an example is we had a team, you know, during the year, I presented this vision idea to my team. And it just happens that 3 months later, two of them decided to self-select and say, I can't see where that's going. It's too much for me. Like, I can't get it. So they actually left within a month of each other. But three other people came on board, and the commentary or the feedback that I've got is that it's an inspiring place to work because there's a picture of where we're going. So
yeah,
that's probably the first thing is you've got to really think, and even if, and you might test this with someone. I think you're having a coach is really great to sort of test, is it big enough? That's probably the first point, I reckon.
Yeah. Look, my general experience is people's vision is small. Yeah. And the reason they think small is they don't want to intimidate anybody. They think people are going to think they're nuts. And so they downplay. Now, the problem is when I downplay my vision, the caliber of person that I attract to my organization is someone who buys in on the downplayed vision. And I know a few people on this call, and they're probably grinning in the back of their mind, because when I start coaching people, I say, look, as we evolve your vision, you are going to lose people. And you're not going to lose them because you're not going to know who it is. Right? You're going to think you know who it is, but as you state the vision, people are going to polarize. And you just touched on that. They're either going to fall in love with the vision and they're going to become highly productive, or they're going to start to realize that it's not them. Now, it's neither good nor bad, right? It's just that now that I'm clear on what I want, people can decide whether they stay or go. And I think the fear people have is, I don't want to rattle the cage. I don't want to lose my people. But here's the problem, you know, if you have the wrong people on the bus and you're scared of losing them, then you don't have the right people. So absolutely, I think, you know, thinking big, and one of my favorite books on the topic, The Magic of Thinking Big, David Schwartz, is an oldie but a goodie. And he actually gives the reasoning behind it. He says, most people do not think big enough. And they think in terms of, I don't want to be too greedy. You know, I don't want to stand out. Tall poppy syndrome in Australia. And so their vision is small. And you go, well, with a small vision, you're going to attract small-minded people. And with a big vision, you might be wrong and you might fail. But I'd rather have a big vision and fail than have a small vision and succeed.
That's right. There's another great book too called by Brian Tracy, you know, 21 Secrets of Self-Made Millionaires.
Yep.
And probably three or four chapters of that 21 is actually thinking big and actually setting big goals. And then a bit like what we're doing today is actually getting there. So
yeah,
that's another good one to think about.
So we've talked a bit about vision and this whole idea of having something bigger than yourself and also putting it out there, which is a vulnerability as well, because a lot of times when we think about our successful leaders and, you know, we talk about, you know, Jeff Bezos with Amazon, and everyone thought he was nuts when he started, and they still think he's nuts. And, you know, Elon Musk. And the reality is these guys have vision. They have a picture of what they think will make the world a better place. And a lot of people are naysayers and go, you're thinking too big. It's no, 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 no. And they push them. And what they did really well, and even Gandhi did this as well, he said, I'm not going to listen to what the public say. Right. Because I think Henry Ford said it well. He said, if I listened to my customer, I would have just built a faster horse. And so exactly. The big thinkers of the world just have a vision of something they believe will make the world a better place. And they go for it.
Yeah.
And as they go for it, they inspire other people who believe in that vision to jump on board. So explain to me, like, obviously you've done this with a few clients. Where are the sort of bottlenecks? Where are the pushback points with the clients as you go through the process?
I think one area is the idea of what the team or the culture looks like, because it can be quite hard to define what is good culture. And if we think about having that big vision, you know, as we know today, it can't be an inspiring company if it's just me in the business. We need to attract the right sort of people. So I think the first bottleneck is actually being really clear about the people that we want to attract. So almost think about people who don't even exist yet. But
yeah.
And it's sort of like more around the way that they think, that they approach, you know, are they abundant thinkers? Are they people who actually treat your business as their own? You know, what's their view, like what's their view on life? And I think that to me, having an understanding, actually not thinking about the people that we have now, but thinking about the people that you ideally would love to have, it can be quite challenging. So
yeah.
I think, I'm not sure what, I know that you have through the same experience, David, when you've been evolving your business, what do you sort of see as important when we talk about an inspiring team and culture?
So culture is about the who, right? And you sort of, you nailed that. And to me, this is an interesting area. And there's a couple of really good case studies. Probably my favorite is Zappos Shoes. So some people aren't familiar with Zappos Shoes, but all you need to know is Tony Hsieh, who started Zappos Shoes, sold it to Amazon for $1 billion with a B, right? Now, the irony of the thing is when he sold it, the condition of sale was that he remains the CEO, right? And the reason he wanted to remain the CEO is because he built the culture. And he said, I'm not selling this to you if you change the culture in my business, because culture for me is everything about what Zappos Shoes is about. Now, anyone who knows, you can jump online, you can Google Zappos, you'll find them. They have a thing called the Culture Book, and it's free, right? They send it to anybody who requests it as a hard copy. And it talks about their values. And the reason he believed values were so important is because when he started the shoe store, and I want you to think back, you know, most people don't like buying shoes online, right? And the reason not is because you want to try them on before you wear them. But his logic was simple. He says, it's still cheaper for me to send you 10 pairs of shoes and you to send back 10 pairs of shoes that don't fit than it is to run a retail store. Because I don't need bricks and mortar, I don't need stock on the shelf, and I don't need to pay wages for people to be standing there waiting for you to walk in. So he had to make his customer service superior. So one of his tenets was, for my customer service to be superior, my culture has to change. It's not a help desk. It's not I have a problem with my order. It's actually got to be better than an experience in a shoe store. So and a local guy, Tristan White, who runs, he's a physiotherapist, and he runs a physiotherapy clinic in Melbourne, I think, and they've got about 20 or 30 practices now. He wrote a really interesting book called Culture is Everything. So he's a local guy, and he talks about the importance of culture as well. And so to me, culture is about the who, okay? And when you talk about vision, we talk about the why. You know, why am I in business? What problem am I solving? And the second question is, what kind of people or what kind of behavior do I want in the people that I bring on the bus? Now, the danger with culture, once again, is you may polarize your people. Because when I ask you personally what's most important to you about your business, first answer is always profitability. Then the second and third and the fourth answers are the important ones, because it's about how people behave within the organization. Now, when we employ on skills, not attitude, typically. And the reason we employ on skills, not attitude, is because we have resumes and we have job descriptions and we have, you know, people graduate university. So they have certification. You don't get certification on attitude, because there's no right or wrong in attitude. There's either alignment or disalignment. And most people don't find that out until after they employ. And doing that after you employ is super expensive. You know, I've already talked about the cost of employment. So putting a culture statement together, and we talked about values when we touched on goals, and putting that into your vision, right, into your vivid vision, and making sure that not only do people know what you're trying to build, but they know what kind of people are in your business or acceptable in your business, is a game changer. So if you're attracting the wrong kind of people, and sometimes the resume looks awesome, right? Hey, this guy's got 10 years experience in our industry and he's got great contacts and we should get him on board. And you get him on board and 3 weeks later you're going, oh my God, he's breaking everything, right? And it's got nothing to do with skills. It's got everything to do with attitude. Yeah.
Yes, so
this is the critical element of culture. And I think most people downplay it because it's soft. You know, what do I stand for? What's important to me? Who cares? Just get me a good salesperson, for goodness sake. Well, there's good salespeople that are precious salespeople, and there's good salespeople that are consultative salespeople. So what's the style that you need in your business? And neither one's right nor wrong, right? It just depends on what you're building. Yeah, great point. So we've talked about vision and we've talked about culture. What other elements are key in this vivid vision exercise?
Probably the next one is talking about the sort of clients or the members that you want to attract. Again, it's similar to people. I remember I was talking to a client, and I know that we started to put together some information about his website and the vision. And I remember I saw a comment on social media that he did when he replied after we did this launch, and it said, as soon as we attract like-minded partners, it will explode. And I thought that's a really interesting comment, because not a lot of people actually think about, you know, it's like when you take on a new client, it's like, great, it's a new client, but has anyone actually stopped to think about what is the ideal person in the future? So the same sort of principles about who we wanting to attract, but also you know, are they on board with how we sort of see the world? And do they see things, do they think things a bit differently? So I remember when we were working on your vivid vision, David, on outcomes, you know, we talked about signing, I think it was 20-year contracts for clients, or 25-year contracts. And that just blows people mind, because I think 25 years, that's like someone's, you know, something could be half person's life or something in working life. So having having the same principles about your team, but actually thinking about what would be someone in a type of client and the way that they think that I'd love to work with? Like what, how have you sort of seen this evolve?
Yeah. So you talked about an interesting point, and I think I was stronger than that. We went for clients for life.
Clients for life. There you go.
Clients for life. And, you know, Rob Jagger helped me coin that term. And we said, look, you know, if we're a coaching firm and you're in business, that at what point should we finish our relationship? Well, as long as you're growing, and for me in business, there's no standing still. You're growing or you're dying. As long as you're growing, you should have a coach. Now, the real question is, can the coach add value all that time? So by saying clients for life, it's not about contracts. Yeah. It's literally about desire, right? So now we rethink, because everyone knows this. It costs more to buy a new client than it does to keep an existing client on board. But if you don't think about clients for life, and one of my earlier sort of business opportunities, we had a mattress store. And we had a real problem, right? Because when you buy a bed, you don't often buy beds, right? You buy beds maybe once every 5 to 10 years. And so our repeat business was low, other than you might buy a bed for your kids and so forth. And I realized there was a flaw in this business model, because there was no recurring business, okay? So now when I look at my business, my first question is, how do I get clients to stay for a long time, right? Not by forcing them, but by making a product range that allows clients for life. So in the vision, the why, right? Because people should be able to grow their business effortlessly, right? For me, business should be a game of making profit, not a game of working harder. So for me, how do we do that? And we talked about the board today, And we said, we're introducing the board as a level of putting peers together, right? So that they can collaborate to grow their business to the next stage. Because whether it's 500,000, 1 million or 100 million, right? Growth is still a critical component, especially for the shareholder. Right? Shareholder doesn't want you to just make profit every year. They want you to improve profit every year. So how are you doing that within your organization? Yeah, fantastic. Mm. So what's the next stage?
From there, thinking about the products and the services.
Yeah.
So again, this can be challenging for people because sometimes that takes that out of the box thinking, because some things won't even exist yet. You know, you talked about the board idea, which is I think it's a wonderful idea, and I'll put my hand up for that just quietly. But in terms of some other things, like to actually think about, I remember I think it was Elon Musk, you know, and Jeff Bezos. They talk about creating products that people don't actually know that they need. So the idea is you actually have, you create something and then people say, oh, I actually need that. And you say, well, of course, because I've created it and I've made it so you need that. So I think that being, and I guess the way that I've seen people do that really well, like if I, if I look at Nick and Mel, you know, from HLS, I'll put you guys in the spotlight for a second. You know, we talk about things like creating a concierge program where it's changes the way that people think about about the health space, because no one does that anymore.
Yeah.
But for them, it was so crucial because it allowed them to, that's a product and service that doesn't exist yet. And it doesn't exist yet in the industry.
Yes.
They're actually creating it. So it will exist, and people will then go, oh, well, this is fantastic. You know, why doesn't anyone else do it? Because you've actually thought that. So, so I think for me, the products and services aspect, if you can think about, I guess you just got to be a bit bold and sometimes take a stab at a few different ideas. So, I mean, I know that you're very innovative the way that you think about products, David. Like, how would you suggest people start to sort of evangelize what?
Well, this becomes a third component. So we've talked about the why, the vision.
Yeah.
We've talked about the who, the culture. And now we're talking about the how. And, one of the books that we've been talking about recently here is the $100 million offer by Alex Hormozi.
Yeah.
And he made an interesting distinction. And he said, if your offering is so good that they'd be silly not to take it, then you don't need to sell hard, right? Because it's a no-brainer. And so when we talk about product and service innovation, I think most people don't realize it's not about creating new products. It's about packaging your existing products. So when we talk about concierge that you just described, and I like Elon Musk because he's an innovator and he does this. And he started SolarCity on the premise that most people don't want to buy solar panels, right? They just want their electricity price to go down. So he said, I'm not going to lock you into 7 years to pay off your solar panels to see a return on investment. I'm going to provide them and at my cost, and you just pay a monthly fee. And that monthly fee is going to be less than your electricity with no lock-in contract. Now, to me, that's a no-brainer offer, right? I don't want to own solar panels. All I want is reduced electricity costs. And if he can offer that in a package, right, that's his offering, right? And so then all of a sudden he can go to the market, and you don't need a good salesperson to come in and say, hey, Andrew, I can reduce your electricity bill with no lock-in contract by putting solar panels on your roof. And if you don't like them, just ring us and we'll take them away. You're going, well, why would I say no to that?
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah.
Unless it's an aesthetic thing, right? I don't like the look of them. So this how part, right? And also sometimes referred to as mission, okay, is really the differentiator, the product differentiator that actually gets you to stand out in the marketplace. And I'm a big fan of this, right? Because I think most people compete. And if you're in a price competitive market right now, I'm going to suggest that your offer is not strong. And if you invest some time building your offer, invest some time in differentiating how you go to market so that people can't compare you with Joe Blogs down the street that's $5 cheaper. The return on investment of improving your offer is it's scalable, because once I fix my offer, then every person I talk to doesn't compare me to Joe Blogs down the street. So I think when we talk about this whole vivid vision and we start thinking about how could you change an industry? Because when you come up with the idea, and you got to remember Jeff Bezos, if you ever read the book, the interesting thing is when he started his office, and there's pictures all over the internet, his desk was a door on trestles, right? And it's a bit of a joke within Amazon is that people upgrade their desk to a door on trestles because that's the message, right? Jeff Bezos started the business on saying, You know, I started in my backyard. Everyone started in their backyard. They had an idea. They conceptualized the idea. They built the vision. They built the differentiator, and they went to market. And inevitably, they fell over themselves 1,000 times, because anyone who knows the Amazon story, they made a lot of products that failed, right? Heaps and heaps of products. But every time they failed, they said, we didn't fail. We learned something. What was the distinction that we learned, and how do we keep that IP to move forward? So when you talk about how, right? And I think for most people, it's innovation, right? It's about thinking, how do I represent myself to the market in a way that's different to my competitor? Because if you go in on price, you are doomed to commoditize. And commoditization is the killer of business. The only way to win in commoditized markets is to go big, like Bunnings, right? And so we all know the story of Masters. Anyone who remembers, Masters decided we can do better than Bunnings, we'll provide better service.
Yeah.
We'll open one next to every Bunnings, and now there's lots of blue buildings all over the place that have been taken over by Aldi and all sorts of different people, right? Because their message was wrong. So that's the how. So let's sort of bring this all together. So we've talked about the why, which is the vision. We've talked about the how, which is the mission or the product or the service, the uniqueness. We've talked about the who, which is the culture. Is there any other components that need to be part of this vivid vision?
Yes, and it's pretty important. It's impact.
Impact.
So what do I mean by impact? Well, we all want to make a buck. We all, that's why a lot of people are in business. You know, it's important. But ultimately, you know, what impact or what's your legacy? And again, this is quite, this can be challenging. But I remember when I was going through the same process for my own, you know, vivid vision, I realized, well, if our mission or if our vision is to help visionary leaders share their knowledge to inspire the world, then How do you do that? And one of the things that resonated with me is around, you know, helping the poorest of the poor in the world. And you can do that. And I founded an organization called Village Enterprise, and their mission is to eradicate poverty through the power of entrepreneurship. So they go into places like, you know, rural Africa, for example, and they teach people who are interested in obviously, to, you know, helping their families, they teach them how to become an entrepreneur. They teach them how to build a business, and they give them all the training and the tools to be able to do that. And they teach them how to impact their families. And I thought, well, there's an impact statement right there that really resonates me, because they want to, you know, in 5 years, they want to help, you know, 20 million people out of poverty, for example.
Amazing.
And I thought, well, if that's almost like the missing piece with this vision, because, and, you know, there's obviously research with, I guess the younger generation that come through, and it's all, people are more in tune with, well, what's the social impact? Like, yes, I'm going to do a job, but what's the real, you know, what's the big picture here that I can latch onto? And it's almost like, I think nowadays everyone needs to have a some sort of impact statement or impact goal.
Well, it is interesting you talk about this, because this is like a turbocharger for me. And we've struggled with this internally, you know, because most people say, well, my impact is to help the people that I serve. Okay. Yeah. But there's a couple of companies that have done a better job than this. There's the Thank You Water Company. There's Tom's Shoes. And their impact was, every pair of shoes that gets bought, we send a pair of shoes to a third world country. And what they're using is, they're using that impact to motivate people to go and spend more on shoes. And so people like to be altruistic. But if you don't give them a channel to do that through your own organization, you're actually shooting yourself in the foot. So I think this idea of impact, it's a tough one, because for some of us, it's like thinking about charity. Oh, yeah, well, I give to charity, right? But are you sharing the impact that you're having on the planet through what you're doing in a way that people buy in on the vision, and they go, well, you stand for this, therefore I'm on board with you? Yeah, that's a fantastic distinction. It's, I'm still struggling with this one, by the way.
And I'll just declare something now, because as you know, if you declare it out loud, then it, you know, it makes it accountable. But next year, we're going to... we're going to have a series of educational events around marketing communications, and have guest speakers like yourself, David, and other great people.
Yep.
And part of that will be that there'll be a percentage that will be donated to this Village Enterprise. And the goal is to help impact, you know, 1,000 people out of extreme poverty. So there's something that you could potentially look at doing as an example. Like, if it doesn't have to be a charity, it could be some sort of impact that resonates with you. And, you know, and if you consider, even if it's something that's, as to say, it could be a figure, it could be something that, a cause that you believe in, but how are you going to, what's your legacy? Because to me, that's why, that was the biggest turnaround for me this year, is about the business is actually a way to get to, it's your legacy, right? So how can you, what can you do?
A means to an end, right? And this is the bigger why, right? Because when we talk about why to make a profit, that's very personal. Why to pay my shareholders, still very personal. Yep. Why to make an impact on the planet, we're now talking about altruistic and we're talking about bigger picture. And, you know, the world's getting smaller. I mean, we've all had this proven to us over the last 2 years, right? The internet has made it the boundaries don't exist anymore. And so can you have impact on the planet? Well, you can if you decide to. But if your vision is too small, right? If your vision's too small, if you're thinking small, then you won't do it. So it's a matter of choice. So it's an interesting point. There is a company that we've been looking at called Buy One, Give One, B1G1.
Okay.
Paul Dunn. And Paul Dunn has been in the personal development space for as long as I've been alive, I think. He's an old guy. Super motivational. And it's a brilliant idea because you can tap into his resource, which is saying, here's all the charities. You get to choose which ones you want to contribute to. And then you become an advocate for them. So making it easier for people to decide is one way to do it. If you're not sure, there's options.
And A Life You Can Save by Peter Singer. Yeah. That's, if you're thinking about this space, impact, that's a great book that really changed the way that I thought about it, this whole idea. So check that out too.
Right. Maybe pop that in the chat after we wrap this one up.
Yep.
So let's bring this all home. So Andrew, let's summarize. So obviously we've been talking about vivid vision and the nuances, the components that might be missing on some people's scorecard. What's the recommendation? So what do people need to do?
I think, the first thing, the key things you need to put in this vision, your values, we didn't touch on that, but what are your five key values? What's your team culture look like? What are your clients and members look like? What are your products and services look like? And what are your impact? So those are the sort of the framework. And I think from there, get out into nature, you know, give yourself a pass, go out, take a half day off and actually spend the time to think about that business in 5 years. And I suggest you take a pad, you don't take your computer, and just write as if, you know, no one's watching. Just write as much as you can. Doesn't have to make sense, but do it to start with and get it all down on paper. And that's the first step.
Yeah.
And then you can polish it later.
Yep.
But yeah.
I've been thinking you're touching on personal vision here as well, because we talk about business, but in reality, we all stand for something. We have our 4,000 weeks on this planet. And if someone said they're counting down, they're not going up, right? And you've got a choice to make an impact or not.
Yeah.
What would you do? And this whole idea of escaping the office, escaping the rat race, and just really, well, until when we get out of lockdown, maybe you can go up to 15 kilometers right now. But getting out of your environment and saying, I need to break the environment to rethink this. And as we move towards the end of the year, I often do this as a Christmas thing. And I say to people, you know, grab a few beers, go sit under a tree somewhere and just think about business. Yeah. Not what problems you have, but if I could hit the reset button and start again, what would I do? Mm. Because I guarantee you that's exactly how all of these leaders we've talked about started. They had an idea. And from that idea, it germinated into a thought process. And then they started leading with that thought process. And people said, that's a great idea. I'm on the bus with you. There's a great little video on this called The Second Follower on YouTube. If anyone Googles The Second Follower on YouTube, it's a classic. It was recorded at a live outdoor concert. And there's this one mad guy who's dancing on his own and he's doing stupid dancing and everyone's laughing at him. And then the second guy joins him. And as soon as the second guy joins him, everyone else joins on board.
Yeah.
Just a fascinating phenomenon because it wasn't rigged. It was actually live. And it just shows, they call it the second follower because the hardest part is to get the first person. Hmm. But as soon as you got the first person following you, other people start to see a movement. And this is, I think, where visionaries need to go. They need to be brave enough to go out there and say, this is what I believe in.
Yes.
Find that second follower, one person. When that second follower confirms what you'll believe in is valuable, then other people see movement as well.
And it doesn't have to be perfect. For all the thinkers out there, like myself, it doesn't have to be perfect.
Yeah.
You just have to put it down. So there's no excuse, really.
Awesome, Andrew. Look, I need to wrap this up. So thanks. Let everyone give Andrew a nice round of applause for contributing today. That was an awesome insight.